So I think we should focus our efforts on trying to develop it safely, and that's very different from trying to slow down the development.
In addition to alignment, what does safe development of AI mean?
Okay. Figuring out how to deal with the short-term risks, and there's many of those, and they all have different solutions. So things like lethal autonomous weapons, and to deal with that, you need things like Geneva Conventions, and we're not going to get those till nasty things have happened. You've got fake videos and images corrupting elections, particularly if they're targeted at particular people. To deal with that, I think you need a much better system for establishing the provenance of a video or an image. Initially, I thought you should mark them as fake. You should insist they're marked as fake. I don't think there's much future in that anymore. I think you're better off insisting that there's a provenance associated with things and your browser can check the provenance. Just as already with email, it says, don't trust this one, I can't establish it. It should be like that. There's discrimination and bias where you can freeze the weights of a system and measure its bias and then somewhat correct it. You'll never correct it perfectly, but somewhat correct it. So you can make the system less biased than the data it was trained on. And so you can replace people by a less biased system. It'll never be unbiased. But if you just keep replacing systems by less biased systems, that's called gradient descent, things will get less biased. So I'm not so worried about that one, possibly because I'm an old white man. There's jobs. We don't really know what to do about that. So you don't get many people digging ditches anymore because a backhoe is just much better at digging ditches than a person. It's going to be the same for almost all mundane intellectual labor. An AI system is going to make a much better paralegal than a person. That's kind of really scary because of what it's going to do to society. It's going to cause the rich to get richer because we're going to get big increases in productivity. And where's that wealth going to go to? It's going to go to rich people, and poor people are going to get poorer. I don't know what to do about that. Universal basic income helps, stops them starving, but it doesn't really solve the problem because people's dignity is gone if they don't have a job. So,
earlier we were talking about perception, and then perception was associated with subjective qualities. Maybe there's a wrong model there. But anyhow, whenever we're speaking about percepts, are we speaking about perception and thus we're speaking about a subjective experience associated with it?
No, when you use the word subjective experience of, you're indicating that you're about to talk about a hypothetical state of the real world. Okay? Not some funny internal thing, but a hypothetical state of the real world. These funny internal things don't exist. So there are no qualia. There's nothing made of qualia. There's just hypothetical states of the world as a way of explaining how your perceptual system is lying to you.
And that's what we mean when we say subjective experience, is these hypothetical states of the world.
That's how we actually use it.
So a prediction or no?
Oh, getting the issue of prediction into it is a sort of red herring. It's a different direction altogether. The thing you have to get in your head is that there isn't a funny kind of thing called a subjective experience that's made of some funny mental stuff. There's just a technique of talking about how your perceptual system goes wrong, which is to say what the world would have had to have been like for it to be telling the truth. And that's what we're indicating. When we use the phrase subjective experience, we indicate that that's the game we're playing. We're playing the game of telling you about hypothetical states of the world in order to explain how my perceptual system's going wrong. A subjective experience is not a thing.
And can anything have a perceptual system? Can a book have a perceptual system? What defines a perceptual system?
Okay, to have a perceptual system, you'd have thought you needed something that can have some internal representation of something going on in some external world. That's what I'd have thought. So like a toad gets light in its eyes and it snaps up flies, and it's clearly got a perceptual system, right? Because it has to see where the flies are.
Yes.
I don't think a book has a perceptual system, because it doesn't, it's not sensing the world and having an internal representation.
What would be the difference between intelligence and rationality?
Okay. So there's various kinds of intelligence. So you wouldn't accuse a cat of being rational, but a cat could be pretty intelligent. In particular, when you talk about rationality, you typically mean logical reasoning. And that's very different from the way we do most things, which is intuitive reasoning. So a nice analogy would be if you take something like AlphaZero that plays chess. I'll use chess because I understand it better than Go. It'll have something that can evaluate a board position and say, how good is that for me? It'll have something that can look at a board position and say, what's a plausible move for me? And then it'll have what's called Monte Carlo rollout, where it's, you know, if I go here and he goes there and I go here and oh dear, that's bad. The Monte Carlo rollout is like reasoning. The neural nets that just say, that would be a good move, or this is a bad position for me, they're like intuitive reasoning. And we do most things by intuitive reasoning. Originally in AI, they wanted to do everything by using reasoning, logical reasoning, and that was a huge mistake, and they couldn't get things done. They didn't have a way of dealing with things like analogy. What neural nets are good at is intuitive reasoning. So what's happened in the last 20 years is we've used neural nets to model human intuition rather than human reasoning, and we've got much further that way.
Is it the case that the more intelligent you are, the more moral you are?
I read something about that recently that suggested it was. But of course, I don't know the provenance of that, so I don't know whether to believe it. I'm not convinced that's true. Here's some evidence. Elon Musk is clearly very intelligent. I wouldn't accuse him of being very moral.
And you can be extremely moral and not terribly intelligent?
I think so, yes. That's my guess.
Well, you said that you weren't entirely sure, so what's the evidence to the contrary? What's the evidence that as you increase in intelligence, your morality increases proportionally somehow?
Well, I mean, I just have no idea whether there's a correlation at all.
I see.
I think there's highly intelligent people who are very bad, and there's highly intelligent people who are very good.
What does it mean to understand?
Okay. That's a question I'm happy to answer. So, again, I think most people have a wrong model of what understanding is. If you look at these large language models, there's many people, particularly people who from the Chomsky School of Linguistics, who say they don't really understand what they're saying. They just are using statistical correlations to predict the next word. If you look at the first models like that, I think I probably made the very first language model that used backpropagation to train the weights to predict the next word. So you backpropagate the error in predicting the next word. And the point of the model was to show how you could learn meanings for words, or to put it another way, to show how you could take a string of words and learn to convert the words into feature vectors and interactions between feature vectors. And that's what understanding is. Understanding a string of words is converting the words into feature vectors. So that you can use interactions between features to do things like predict the next word, but also to do other things. So you have a sentence which is a string of symbols. let's not talk about word fragments. I know these transformers use word fragments, but let's suppose they used whole words. It's easier to talk about.
Right.
And it would just make them work a bit worse, that's all. They'd still work.
Sure.
So I give you a string of words, some text. The meaning isn't in the text. What you do is you convert those words into feature vectors, and you've learned how feature vectors in context, how the features should interact with each other to do things like disambiguate the meanings of ambiguous words. And once you've associated features with those words, that is understanding. That's what understanding is. And that's what understanding is both in a large language model and in a person. In that sense, we understand in the same basic way they understand. It's not that when we understand, there's some magical internal stuff called understanding. I'm always trying to get rid of magical internal stuff in order to explain how things work. We're able, using our big neural networks, to associate features with these symbols in such a way that the features all fit together nicely. So here's an analogy I quite like. If you want to model 3D shapes, and you're not too worried about getting the surface just right, you can use Lego blocks. So it's a big shape, like a car. You can make something the same shape as a Porsche with Lego blocks. The surface won't be right, but it'll have the same space occupancy.
Sure.
So Lego blocks are a kind of universal way of modeling 3D structures. And you don't need many different kinds of Lego block. Now, think of words as like Lego blocks, except that there's a whole bunch of different Lego blocks with different names. What's more, each Lego block has some flexibility to it. It's not a rigid shape like a Lego, like a piece of Lego. It can change in various directions. It's not completely free. The name tells you something about how it can change.
Okay.
But there's some flexibility to it. And sometimes there'll be a name and it's two completely different shapes it can have. But it can't have any old shape. So what we've invented is a system for modeling much more complicated things than the 3D distribution of matter, which uses high-dimensional Lego blocks. So they're Lego blocks with, say, 1,000 dimensions. And if you're a mathematician, you know 1,000-dimensional spaces are very weird things. And they have some flexibility. And I give you the names of some of these Lego blocks, and each of which is this 1,000-dimensional underlying.
Sure.
And they all deform to fit together nicely, and that's understanding. So that explains how you can learn the meaning of a word from one sentence without any definitions. So if, for example, I say, she scrummed him with the frying pan, you have a sense of what scrummed means. It's partly phonetic, but because the ED on the end tells you it's a verb. But you think it probably means she hit him over the head with it or something like that. It could mean something different. She could have impressed him with it. You know, she cooked such good omelets that that really impressed him. It could mean she impressed him. But probably it means she hit him over the head or something like that, something aggressive like that. And you get that from just one sentence. And nobody's telling you this is a definition of scronged. It's just that all the other Lego blocks for the other words, she and him, and all those other words, adopt shapes that fit together nicely, leaving a hole. And that hole is the shape you need for scrummed. So now that's giving you the shape that scrummed should be. So that's how I think of language. It's a modeling system we've invented, where there's some flexibility in each of these blocks. I give you a bunch of blocks, and you have to figure out how to fit them together. But because they all have names, I can tell other people about what my model is. I can give them the names. And if they share enough knowledge with me, they can then figure out how they all fit together.
So are you suggesting, help the audience understand what understanding...
I think what's going on in our heads, and that's what's going on in these large language models, so they work the same as us. And that means that they really do understand.
One of Chomsky's counterarguments to that the language models work the same is that we have sparse input for our understanding. We don't have to feed the internet to ourselves. So what do you say to that?
It's true that the language models are trained on much more data. They are less statistically efficient than us. However, when children learn language, they don't just learn it by listening to the radio. They learn it by being in the real world and interacting with things in the world. And you need far less input if you train a multimodal model. It doesn't need as much language. And the more, if you give it a robot arm and a camera and it's interacting with the world, it needs a lot less language. So that's one argument. It still probably needs more than a person. The other argument goes like this. The backpropagation training algorithm is really good at packing a lot of knowledge into a few weights, where a few is a trillion, if you give it a lot of experience. So it's good at taking this huge amount of experience, sucking the knowledge out, and packing it into a relatively small number of weights, like a trillion.
Just a moment. Don't go anywhere. Hey, I see you inching away. Don't be like The Economy. Instead, read The Economist. I thought all The Economist was something that CEOs read to stay up to date on world trends. And that's true, but that's not only true. What I found more than useful for myself, personally, is their coverage of math, physics, philosophy, and AI, especially how something is perceived by other countries and how it may impact markets. For instance, The Economist had an interview with some of the people behind DeepSeek the week DeepSeek was launched. No one else had that. Another example is The Economist has this fantastic article on the recent dark energy data, which surpasses even Scientific American's coverage, in my opinion. They also have the chart of everything. It's like the chart version of this channel. It's something which is a pleasure to scroll through and learn from. Links to all of these will be in the description, of course. Now, The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means that you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments. I am personally interested in the more scientific ones, like this one on extending life via mitochondrial transplants, which creates actually a new field of medicine, something that would make Michael Levin proud. The Economist also covers culture, finance and economics, business, international affairs, Britain, Europe, the Middle East, Africa, China, Asia, the Americas, and of course, the USA. Whether it's the latest in scientific innovation or the shifting landscape of global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage, and it goes far beyond just headlines. Look, if you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a new understanding, a deeper one, of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. I subscribe to them, and it's an investment into my, into your intellectual growth. It's one that you won't regret. As a listener of this podcast, you'll get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now let's get back to the exploration of the mysteries of our universe. Again, that's economist.com/toe.